All right, welcome back to the channel. Today I'm gonna show you how to use Hyper-V. I'm gonna go through all the settings, setup, all the little bugs and glitches that you can run into with this because I've been dealing with these for a little while myself and had to find workarounds for all this stuff. So let's go ahead and jump right into it. So to start off, in order to be able to use Hyper-V, you do have to be using Windows 10 Pro or above. This doesn't work on home because Hyper-V is not a feature on the Windows Home Edition. So if you have Windows Pro or above and you want to turn this on, just go down to your search bar, type in turn Windows features on or off, and you'll see this option show up here where you can click on a box and this window comes up. In order to use Hyper-V, you have to go down here. Now there's only a couple of things you have to do here for a minimal install. You just need Hyper-V hypervisor and services, and then you need to install a Hyper-V GUI management tools. You don't need the module for Windows PowerShell. Once you click OK, Windows is going to go ahead and install that stuff, and then you can go ahead and start up Hyper-V. Then once you have that done, just go back to your search bar, type in Hyper-V, and you'll have the option to go ahead and open up the Hyper-V manager. So let me go ahead and take you through some stuff on here so you have an idea of what it is that you're looking at. So I've used this to make Linux VMs, which I'll cover that here in just a second. There are some issues with those that you have to keep in mind if you're going to use this. If you're going to use Linux, I would recommend just using VirtualBox or VM, because I've had a lot of issues trying to get Linux distros to run properly in Hyper-V. But we'll go over that here pretty soon. What we're going to do is start out with the Hyper-V settings first, and then we're going to go ahead and start going through the settings to actually configure your virtual machines. So let's go ahead and start with Hyper-V settings. Now, most of this you don't really need to worry about. I'm not going to go through every setting on here because most of it really isn't all that important. Like I said, if you want to change this stuff, you can. Like where you put your virtual hard disks. This stuff really isn't anything that you need to spend all that much time focusing on. The one thing I would recommend checking out is the enhanced session mode. What this does is it allows extra features for things like video and audio. It allows clipboard sharing. Now there's some security issues with that if you're going to use it, which I'll cover here pretty soon. But I would recommend, unless you're going to be doing things like malware testing inside of a VM, it makes it a little easier to use these virtual machines if you have this setting enabled. And then you can come down here and click use session mode, enhanced session mode whenever it's available. Now that we've done that, that's really the only big thing you need to worry about there. Let's just go ahead and click new and create virtual machine. Now you can do a quick create. I'm gonna go ahead and go through the full process. That way you can see all the different options and some things that you need to keep an eye on. So first off, you can name all your virtual machines, which I would strongly recommend doing. So I've got like Windows Pro. I didn't name these two, and I can't remember what they're for at this point because I haven't used them in forever. So being specific with your names is definitely better. The next big thing to pay attention here is the generation of the virtual machine. So this is basically like the virtual, basically like a BIOS that it's being given. So Gen 1, so when we're talking about using Linux on Hyper-V, some of the distros that I've used, I've been able to get Gen 2 to work just fine. In others, I could not get Gen 2 to work. I had to use Gen 1. Now, if you're going to use, like, let's say Windows 10 or Windows 11, I strongly recommend you just use Gen 2. If you wanted to say, let's say Windows XP, you would probably be fine with using something like Gen 1. Also, just something to keep in mind, if you are using one of the older operating systems, you cannot use anything older than Windows XP. So if you want to use something like Windows 95, you'll need to use something like VirtualBox instead. So what I'm going to do is go ahead and just click Gen 2. Then you can move forward, select whatever amount of RAM it is that you want, and you can use dynamic memory, which I would recommend just using. That way you don't need to use like the full amount. So like if you put 16 gigs, and dynamic memory is checked, it's not actually going to end up using 16 gigs. The next thing, also something to keep in mind, you can go ahead and allow internet by default, and you can also change this later. So if you do not want internet during the setup process, let's say you're going to put an operating system on one of these VMs, you can not give it internet at first, and then you can give it internet later through the VM settings. One thing to keep in mind, because a lot of people on this channel watch cybersecurity stuff, if you have blocked internet access to svchost.exe, even if you try to enable an internet connection, it will not work. You have to make sure that that is allowed. I know a lot of people like using something like SimpleWall. So if you have any sort of blocked internet access for svchost, you need to make sure that's allowed in order for the internet to work on here. Next thing, you can either create a virtual hard disk. This is dynamic, so just because it says 127 gigabytes doesn't mean that that's actually going to take up 127 gigs. It's dynamically allocated. So like if your Windows install comes out to like, let's say 20 gigs, that's what the VM is going to assign to it. You can also use an existing virtual hard disk so you don't have a big mess of virtual hard disks. So let's say you want like three different Windows installs, you can throw them all on the same hard disk. You can also click attach virtual hard disk later. Not a big deal. And then just this last option that comes up here will let you select image file to install like Windows or Linux or whatever it is that you want to install. So then I'm just going to go ahead and click cancel out of here because we're basically done with that process. Now I'm not going to go through the process of installing an operating system because it's just the same as if you installed it on bare metal. It's going to go through the boot up process. You install everything as normal. There's no special considerations. Like let's say you just want to install Windows. It's super easy, not really an issue at all. One thing I would recommend checking out ahead of time before you go ahead and do that is to go ahead and click and change some settings before you actually boot into your VM for the first time. So let's go ahead and select the individual settings for this virtual machine right here. So I'm gonna go ahead and click settings here and we're gonna go through some stuff. So you can add different hardware controller, SCSI controllers and things like that. If you're just looking for basic stuff, you don't need to worry about that. Security, this part's important, so let me cover this. So like on Windows 11, for example, you do absolutely have to use this, like I said, unless you're using a modified ISO that does not have the requirements for things like Secure Boot or TPM 2.0. Let's go ahead and take a look. So when you're enabling Secure Boot, it's important if you're going to install Linux, you need to select the Microsoft UEFI certificate authority if you're going to turn Secure Boot on, because this will only work with Windows installs. This will work with Linux distributions. This one you don't need to worry about. This is for enterprise Linux like SUSE Enterprise or Red Hat Enterprise. So this one you don't have to worry about. It's either Windows or Linux for this one. Next thing, I would enable turning on TPM. You don't really have to. Like if you're gonna install Windows 11, you do have to. You don't really have to do this, but like if you're gonna do any sort of malware testing or if you wanna check, if you're one of those people who likes to download random weird files and you wanna check if it's infected, you need to harden your VMs as much as possible. I'm gonna cover some security stuff here in just a moment. But it's good to have this stuff turned on. The other thing, if you're going to test malware, now I don't recommend people test malware unless you have a lot of experience covering this stuff. It's a really bad idea to do it for a couple different reasons. First of all, a lot of malware these days is being written so they can detect if it's inside of a VM. And so it will either not execute or it will go through what looks like a normal process to a person and then they'll transfer it out to their regular computer and then boom, they get infected because a lot of these viruses are able to detect, oh, we're running inside of a VM. The other issue is that, and it's very rare, but viruses occasionally are written to where they can jump out of a VM and infect the host machine. So I don't recommend using VMs unless you really know what you're doing. I don't recommend doing this to test out malware. But if you're going to, you do want to make sure that you also enable shielding. And if you do, it will enforce all of this stuff. It also does some extra things like it disables PowerShell Direct. But other than that, we don't really need to worry about anything else in here all that much. Memory, you can come in here and change this later. I gave this VM 8 gigs of RAM, but again, you can select and change all this as you want to. The memory weight down here matters only if you are going to have multiple virtual machines running on your computer. So let's say you have 5 different ones running. You might want to select the weight of memory weight high on the ones that are really important and turn it to low on the ones that really aren't. Processor, this one's self-explanatory. You can change what is allocated as far as processors. All this is self-explanatory. One thing that you do get with Hyper-V, which you basically get with any, with like VMware or VirtualBox or anything like that, is things that are known as checkpoints. So you can create a virtual machine. Let's say you want to fresh install Windows and you want to goof around with some stuff a little bit. You can create these checkpoints. So go and make changes to a Windows machine. Let's say you break something, roll back to that checkpoint, then boot up like nothing ever happened. Other than that, there's really nothing else in here that needs to be covered. Like the default settings for a lot of this stuff is just fine. And one thing I did mention earlier, if you do decide that you want to disable internet at first and then enable it later, you can switch between those two in here. So default switch, this means that it would boot up with internet enabled. Not connected means it's not going to have internet allowed. Now there's a couple other things that I want to show you as it relates to running the VM. So let's go ahead and boot into Windows and I'm going to show you what it is that I'm talking about. So when you're booting into Windows, it's going to ask you, or whatever, let's say you have a Linux distro or whatever, it's going to ask you what do you want for your display size. I'm just going to choose this default 1366, 768 pixels. Now when we're inside here, there's a couple of things I want to show you. So I talked about the enhanced session. So that option is up here. Now the issue is if you're going to run, gotta love the glitchiness of this thing. I'm sure people probably watched that video of the Windows hardening tools where I dropped an F-bomb on video. It's because these things, Hyper-V's been a little bit glitchy for me, especially with Linux VMs. Like I said, if you're gonna use Linux, I really recommend you just stick with VMware VirtualBox. This works fine for Windows, but I've had a lot of issues with Linux on this. So I talked about the enhanced session. So when you have enhanced session, you can do things like come in here and dynamically the size of your screen for your virtual machine. So let's say you want to expand it out like this. Now on Windows Home, you cannot do this. So on Windows Home, you do not have this option to resize things, which you have to do on Windows Home. And with basically like most of the Windows or most of the Linux distros that I've used, what you have to do then is go into display settings and change your, and here we go again, we're gonna keep glitching. Again, Hyper-V is, this thing's been kind of a pain in the ass, and now it's not showing me options to change the display resolution for some reason, whereas before it was. So gotta love how this stuff works sometimes. Earlier when I was booted into this, I could change display resolution. The other thing that you can do is also change this on Linux. So what you'll have, so let's say you wanna change it to like 1440 by 900. So if you don't have enhanced session enabled, this will not work. And the only way that you can do it is to change your display setting. The other thing that I want to show you, so the other thing you'll end up seeing, like especially when you're installing like Linux or Windows or something like that, is you'll have options to change your zoom level. Okay, so I had to boot into Windows Home Edition because I don't know what was going on, but that was glitching. It seems like every time I do a video where I'm trying to use something in Hyper-V, it starts glitching out like crazy. So here's the example of what I was talking about with the display resolution. So you can come in here and change this because I'm on Windows Home now, so I no longer have this option down here to resize, which is super fucking annoying. I don't know why in the hell Microsoft does that with their some of their features. And here we go with the glitches again. Now the other thing with this is, let's say you are installing like Windows or Linux or something like that, you're having issues with the view size because you can't change this stuff. So like on Windows, so like Windows Pro, for example, you have to wait until it's installed in order for the option to show up down here where you can change the size. And I can't change the size on this unless I change the display settings. But let's say you're installing something, you're like, okay, well, this is really annoying, I need to change something. But let's say you end up by accident clicking on 25%. Now what you can do, and I fixed this on mine, but it happens to a lot of people where they will click up here and it will make the screen so small to where they can no longer change anything on here. It's, again, it's really ridiculous. But let's say you've made it so that it's no longer where you can change anything here. It gets, what can happen is when you're first using Hyper-V, you can select the option here where it goes so small that you can't even see the option to come up here and change anything in your view. If that happens, here's what you have to do. You need to go to File Explorer. You need to have hidden files and folders turned on in your options up here. So you can go up here, click on Options, enable hidden files and folders. Then you need to go to Users. Then you need to go whatever your username is. So let's say it's John, then you click on John's folder. Then you click on app data, roaming. So you go through this whole list here. Then you have to click on vmconnect.config. You can go ahead and open that with Notepad. And what you have to do from inside here is this will be at whatever value. So let's say it got changed to like, let's say you put it at like 10%. You can no longer see the options inside of Hyper-V to change it. And so you're like, okay, well, it's just glitched and I can't use it anymore. All you have to do is come in here and change this. So like, let's say it's 10 where you can't see it. Just change it to 100, which is the normal value, the 100%. So it's like normal view, save it, and Hyper-V will work properly. Again, when you open it up, the windows will be in the proper size. So that's pretty much it for VMs, for using Hyper-V. I know this stuff seems like really glitchy and really bad. For the most part, it's been pretty decent. Like I said, whenever I'm making videos about Hyper-V is when it tends to like glitch out and do all this weird shit. because I can use this stuff no problem a lot of other times and have no issues with it. It's whatever. I mean, sometimes this thing's just an absolute mess. At any rate, that's going to wrap the video up. If you have any questions, drop them down below. Let me know. And with all that being said, I will see you on Monday.